I'm a principal analyst at Forrester Research, which is a research and consulting company. I'm part of the customer experience team. I focus primarily on topics around design. So actually I have in my, I thought this might just be a little bit useful to give some context as to, you know, what I've been thinking about and why I'm possibly here to hopefully offer some opinions. So some of the research is about the output of design. So it might be interface design and design of experiences. It also is about design methods and processes. So some things I've done, make this website redesign your last. I've been through several website redesigns. And so this is much more about kind of how do you make something more iterative. We did a digital user experience review, which I've found to be very helpful when going through our assignments. So we're actually just about to launch this best practices for retail sites, which is applying that review. Future customer experiences, which is more like here's all these physical, digital, omnichannel, all this stuff kind of coming together. What does it mean for how we think about sort of navigating those spaces? Ways to improve digital customer experience, power of discipline simplification, which is my holy grail all the time. And then one thing I'm working on right now is titled to be determined, mastering the physical digital spectrum. So that kind of gives you hopefully a little bit of sense of, you know, I've done the, you know, managed a design and development team, taking them from, you know, into an agile process, many website redesigns, working on online ticketing, mobile programs, so I can certainly talk about all those things. But I think the reason I'm here is to maybe kind of end our last session with a little bit of a, you know, thinking beyond museums, some thought starters. And I have to admit, I kind of hate the word omnichannel. So, but until we come up with something better, what we have, and this is actually a published Forrester definition about omnichannel. So I'll just read it for you, those of you in the back of the room. So omnichannel actions are those activities and processes that harmonize information and resources across digital and store touch points to improve customer, oh, this is specifically for retail, I should say. Digital and store touch points to improve customer experiences or retailer efficiency and to drive increased sales, customer satisfaction, resource productivity, or profitability. So that's kind of everything, right? So it's digital and non-digital, it's front of house, it's back of house.
Sounds kind of like our e-commerce definition.
Yeah. So I thought it was helpful to start what I'm talking about with omnichannel because I'm going to go in a little bit of a broader application of it too. And this is actually what I was starting to refer to yesterday. And good, I'm glad Alan's come back into the room because this is one of the things we recently published as a forecast. So in 2020, 55% of all retail sales will either be influenced by or occur online. Now, I think what's actually really interesting about this graph is, so the bottom, this bottom, I know I'm walking away from the, is the online sales. This is web-influenced offline sales, and this is offline sales. So what you actually see, the biggest piece of online is about having how online is influencing the in-person. So I don't want to underestimate the value of online for the physical experience. Looking perplexed on that one. So, yeah, 87% will still take place in stores if you think about those two categories together. Now, keep in mind, I'm talking about all, you know, other retailers. This is not about museums. This is broader industry information. But I thought it would be useful to bring to this group as you start to think about, you know, these different channels and where your balance of resources and things go. So, and I think it was great to follow Catherine because this, you know, this really sort of points out that you may be mobile, but what you want to do in different places in terms of retail is quite different, right? So if you're actually in the store, you might be, you know, looking to find out more about a product or, you know, see about loyalty programs. You know, there's something that you want to do, find items on a shopping list perhaps. If you're in, you know, say a competitor store, I'm not sure who your competitor store would be, but let's say you're in a competitor store, you might be doing a price comparison, which people do all the time. Or if you're at home, you might be planning a trip or, you know, making a shopping list, finding out when the store is open. So there, again, very different uses for, in this case, digital in these different locations. And so what you, those requirements or those feature sets that you need are going to be very different based on that context. And one of the things, too, that I think we forget about, so one of the things, well, one of the things, if, yeah, we forget about with thinking about this stuff is that we think about this sort of customer as this person who's in the same space at the same time when they come to the store. And in fact, there's this whole, what we call customer life cycle, which is really thinking about different ways to, and different needs at different times. So for example, in this case, you know, discover is about, you know, is just that, sort of discovery and finding out what that thing might be, or identifying a need or desire or something like that. Exploring might be getting more information in order to make a decision about purchasing. Purchasing, buying, but in the most convenient channel. So going back to what Catherine was saying about, you know, different people will have different uses, how you use it, asking questions about it, engaging with it. And so this is sort of the cycle that keeps going through. But it's not just, you know, we tend to focus just on the buy part or just on the marketing part. We don't really think through all of these other parts of this experience. So I just, you know, kind of want us to start to put that in our minds, because in fact, you have different touch points that become more and more applicable at different parts of this process. So you might, you know, spend more time on the web when you're exploring and trying to figure out whether you want to buy something. You might go into the store itself to actually do the purchase. You might call somebody on the call center for an engagement. So if you think about it from that point of view, you start to think about all these different pieces that come together for this omnichannel experience. Sorry, I'm talking really fast because I have a lot of slides here to go through. And I think this also goes back to the earlier points too, is that, you know, in addition to having different personas, we'd have people who treat technology differently and have different relationships with it. So, you know, the top category, they will buy through these digital touch points. The bottom ones, probably not so much or not regularly. So you have super shoppers, right? They're gonna buy through traditional devices, through mobile, through portable, whatever. Mobile shoppers, and they're really more focused on those mobile devices. Traditional web shoppers, kind of doing both, but or more traditional desktop or laptop. And then researchers, you know, again, they're fine spending all this time researching online, but they're not going to complete that purchase there. And then holdouts, you know, people who are not so interested in the devices. So again, this notion of how do we think about the kinds of things that you're offering to people who have different ways of shopping and approaching your retail environment. So I think, you know, the point being that omnichannel, you know, that crazy definition in the beginning is really about, you know, it's the customer, it's where they are in this life cycle, it's where they are physically, and it's the channel, the sort of form factor of this. So, you know, all of those kind of come together to be what we call the omnichannel experience. So what I would like to propose too, this is a chart from a company called Continuum, and I really like it because it sort of takes this idea of physical and digital and expands it a little bit. So the top and bottom, physical and virtual, are about like where you experience it. Is it in place or is it virtually located? And then and the left and right, is it a human interaction? Are you dealing with an actual person, or is it a digital interaction or a digital experience? So you end up with things like on the lower left, you have physical stores where you have an interaction with a salesperson, a sales associate, real people. And then on the upper right, you've got things like self-service applications, right? Or AI systems where it's entirely remote and digital. So if you start to think not just all in one clump, but in sort of where in these four quadrants you're thinking about those particular experiences, then you start to get toward what we were thinking about as a more holistic experience. So, when we talk about customer-centric companies, I mean, I think what's been interesting for me coming to Forrester is this whole flip around of not thinking, you know, what is it, what are the features that we want to put out there because we think that they'll like it? What are the features that, you know, what's our kind of list of requirements that's coming from the business? And it's sort of flipping that whole discussion around and saying, who are the people coming to us? Who are our customers, visitors, whatever name you want to give them? And how do we think about what it is we want to them to experience? Yes. Oh, 5 minutes. Okay. So this one's for Catherine. So I just wanted to talk about a couple of focuses for Omnichannel. And so this is about eliminating customer pain. I think you mentioned that a couple of times in your talk. So this is about automating repetitive or mundane tasks. So again, that notion of with the Starbucks, and at first I didn't do it either because I was like, I don't want to download the app. I don't want to get set up. And then I started to do it and I've never looked back because you walk in the line and everybody's in line. You're like, and you go pick up your coffee and walk out the door. But that notion that if it is repetitive, is there a way we can make it easier? This is actually eliminating outdated steps. This is a garage in a shopping mall in England. And one of the things that they have is they have a kind of... It's almost like an easy pass type of thing, and so regular customers can kind of come in and go out, and they get charged automatically, so you don't have to stop and do the whole ticketing thing. But then they also do this thing, like, this is so obvious. They tell you where there's an available spot, so you don't have to spend all that time like going around and around in circles. So they sort of said, how can we make this a more efficient parking experience, and thought about not only that flow within the garage, but how you get in and out of it. This one, focusing on experience high points, so this one is about paying for a bill while you're still sitting there eating, so you don't actually have to ask for the check and figure out who's going to pay for it and do all this stuff. You can basically, once your order is done and you're still in process, you can sort of say, okay, pay it, and then get up and go and leave whenever you want. So suddenly you're ending that meal on whatever high note you want as opposed to the paying and the sort of the downer of losing the money. Again, and this one is increased transparency. So this is UPS is doing a beta testing, like being able to see where your package is in transit. So, instead of those steps of like, it left the warehouse, like, where did it go? And then a couple of days later, it shows up. Right? Now you can actually see where it is moving across. So they're, testing that out. Because, the people have that, uncertainty about where their things are. This is about introducing new experience models. So this is it's actually a builder showroom, and they used to have like all of the bricks and flooring and little models of bathrooms and living rooms and things, and people would come in and they'd be overwhelmed by the choice and they wouldn't know where to start or how to think about what it is that they wanted to do. So what they did is they put a lot of this kind of like quizzes, style quizzes and questionnaires online that they answered beforehand, and allowed the people who are working here to, instead of thinking about 50,000 different options, they could narrow it down to sort of a selection. So when the customer comes in, they've got these like style boards of the different options. So they're choosing from like 10 flooring options as opposed to 10,000. And there's a way to kind of guide and direct that experience that is much more simplified. And again, they've been winning all these awards, and people, they shortened the time. I think it was from like 3 months to 30 days for the design process, and it allowed them to put in a no change policy because they got so close on that first round that there wasn't all this like indecision because somebody was like, oh my God, I didn't choose the right thing. I should have, picked that other thing that was over there. So thinking about how can you, with this sort of plethora of choice, how can you help give the most appropriate options to somebody? And this is another one for the experience model thing, and this is a perch interactive table for a Levi's store, and essentially it's the product just sitting there with, essentially some basic label, but when you pick it up, you start to get more of a story about the making of the item or some different history. I thought it was a sort of nice way of, you don't have to do anything. You can just go and find your jeans and whatever, but if you pick it up, you kind of get a little bit of a sort of in-depth story or surprise. This one is about giving customers control, so expanding the choice. So this is a Hilton app where you can actually choose the room that you're going to be in. So instead of choosing a category of room, you can actually be like, I'm going to be in, because I hate being by the elevator, and I always get put by the elevator. So this allows you to sort of pick away from the elevator. I think I travel too much. But that notion is, I have control over my stay here, and they've included this with digital keys and things like that. So again, giving that sort of sense of empowerment. Self-service, so this is a crazy restaurant in San Francisco. I don't know if you've been. It's basically like the new version of the automat. So you can do it either through a kiosk or a mobile app, and your food basically comes out in a window and you pick it up. And then this is about taking immediate action. So thinking about those moments when you're anxious and being able to have some control over it. So this is Discover Card, basically that freeze at your account. So if you think you lost your credit card, you can immediately freeze it. If you find it, you can unfreeze it and go on your merry way. Otherwise, you can cancel it and get a new card, but without having to call somebody or do all that sort of thing. So thinking about, you know, and this one was interesting because they did a journey mapping exercise to figure out where the customer pain points were, and then they targeted those particular moments and said, what kind of solution can we offer that would fix this anxiety that people have, and sort of the time that happens, and also the inefficiency when they actually find their card after they've canceled it. And then thinking about, I wanted to bring up something about text too, because I think that's an interesting thing to think about with retail in terms of customer experience and that support option. So this is actually Nordstrom. You can interact with an associate who will help you, you know, find your perfect shoes when you're not at the store. So being able to feel like you actually have access to the sales staff when you're not in the physical environment. And then this is an example of artificial intelligence. So the idea, again, this notion of how can we take the concept of an associate in the store who's helping you make a selection and offer that same kind of experience online. So in this case, you know, asking you sort of preferences, but more about design. And it starts to learn your preferences as you go and make recommendations for you, not based on, you know, just brown boots, but sort of details that you like and things like that. And then this is, I think I'm going to pick up on this one later. And then this one is about proactive action. So Delta has, and a few airlines now have this, but all these terminals where you can order food. One of the things that I like about this is that if you put in your flight number and you go to order, let's say you go to order the, you know, slow cooked or the souffle or something that takes 30 minutes, they'll be like, I'm sorry, you know, you don't have enough time for that. Do you really want that souffle? And it's sort of this nice thing where, you know, suddenly instead of being in the situation where you've ordered something that you know, you're shoving it in your mouth before you get on the plane, it helps you manage that experience. So we also do this benchmark, functionality benchmark, to think about the different kinds of experiences. I'm probably out of time, aren't I? Okay. I'll run through this quickly, but on the online experience, the channel consistency, which I think we've talked about, in-store pickup, which we haven't actually really talked about. I don't know if it's something that is a big thing for you all or something to think about, and in-store functionality. And I'm just going to, you know, you'll have these slides, but essentially the online experience is about the continuity of information resources across all those digital touch points, right? So is the product available on the website and on the mobile app, right? Or the mobile website. Channel consistency is across digital touch points and physical stores. So it, you know, the thing that I found out about here, can I get access to it over here? Things like offers and promotions, are they consistent across devices and channels? You know, is the loyalty program accessible across those?
So this is
a benchmark, a functionality benchmark that Forrester does, and they give you a score. And essentially, this is how sort of weighting, looking at all the kind of omnichannel. So the online experience is 25% of it, channel consistency 20. In-store pickup is 35%, actually. I mean, that's a big deal. I think it's maybe less applicable here. But that notion of being able to find out if it's available in the store before you go there and have it held for you, either reserved or advanced purchase. And then in-store functionality, so the presence and use of those omnichannel capabilities in the store itself. So wanted to, this is my last little example, but this one is a company called Oak Labs, and they're working, don't tweet this, with Ralph Lauren. Well, this is out in the store, but they're working on another thing that's in beta. But what it is it's basically a smart mirror in the dressing room, and you can, you know, call up other products and sizes and colors and things. You can change the lighting, so you can see whether you look good in your cocktail dress in an evening light. But what I think is really interesting about this one too, you can actually ask for help from an associate in one of six languages, and it will translate for the associate in whatever language the associate speaks. So suddenly, you know, rather than being stranded in this dressing room trying to figure out how to, you know, get your clothes back on so you can go out and get this other thing, you can have somebody come and be able to assist you in that way. The thing that they're now working on too is a little bit more of taking the sort of data about what people are buying and trying on and things, and giving recommendations about where to place products in the store. So I have this thing called explicit and implicit technology. So I think it's, you know, what is the technology that's visible, that's kind of directly accessible to the customer? What is it that's explicit to the back of house and therefore implicit to the customer, right? So they should only see that the experience is somehow better. They don't necessarily know that there's a sort of stockroom app that's giving recommendations to the staff, right? So I think that's where we're kind of getting to in terms of that the retail experience. So I think that, you know, when I talk to these companies who are trying to work with different retailers to do some of these initiatives, the things that they're really looking for are, you know, do they have POS constraints? Like, are they really locked into a system that doesn't have any ways into it or out of it? Inventory inaccuracy, like that's a really big deal. The lack of digital parity, and then 360-degree CRM. So we've talked about a lot of these things, but, you know, if you want to think about where you're going in the future, getting these things down is going to be key for the here and now, I think. And I had some data points if we have time, but I do want... This one's obvious, you know, mobile's growing, it's great. Mobile is the top priority of online retailers. I did want to point this out. So in terms of mobile over marketing and then site merchandising and then checkout overhaul, omnichannel efforts is actually sort of further down. So, you know, people are still very much focused on getting the mobile part right. And it has been that way for the last couple of years. And then in terms of the technology, so that's really more from the retailer business point of view, and then from the technologies, number one, and this was from the Q3 of last year, responsive personalization, CRM, mobile app, product recommendations, e-commerce platform. So, you know, you're not alone. the big stores out there are still having the same issues too. And then how to use phones, how people are using phones, challenges with purchasing on phones. I think this might be interesting that PayPal, that the use of PayPal, this when I first saw this chart, it really surprised me that PayPal was so high. So that's also something to think about. And then Apple Pay, you know, coming along, but still pretty nascent. And then shipping is a big deal. And I remember the conversations at MoMA, shipping is a big deal. But it's a really important piece of that online shopping experience. And so this was from Q1 of this year in terms of, you know, they, like, for example, the top one is I always choose the cheapest shipping option, right? So that's what, I mean, people are looking for inexpensive or free shipping. So if there's any way for you to address this from a business point of view and think about ways to make that shipping faster, easier, cheaper, that will certainly help your online sales. That's it.